All right, good evening. Welcome, everyone. Good evening. And welcome this evening to a special meeting of the Kenosha Unified School District Board. District number one, notice of this special meeting was given to the public by forwarding a copy of the notice to all requesting radio stations and the Kenosha News and the Kenosha Labor. The purpose of this meeting is to have discussion action regarding School Board Policy Rule 6432 class size and discussion action preliminary budget for the 2013-14 school year. So we will work through these items quickly. And thank you for coming this evening. It's great to see everybody there. I've heard from so many people, and I am so glad that we have such a large community of people that are paying attention to what's going on in our schools and that we're working together to just make and improve and tweak out the things that we need to do to educate our students in the most positive manner that we possibly can. So thank you. And thank you for your patience with this budget process. It's been a little bit longer process. We've got some different things that we want to look at. So I appreciate everybody's hard work and your patience with all of this. And I'd like to thank all my fellow board members as well. And we'll get started with a roll call vote, please, Stacy.
Mrs. Taube.
Here.
Mr. Flood.
Here.
Mr. Nuzzo.
Here.
Mrs. Snyder.
Here.
Mrs. Coleman.
Here.
Mr. Bryan.
Here.
Ms. Stevens.
Here. All right, so we will go right on to item number one, discussion action, School Board Policy Rule 6432, class size. May I get a motion, please? Thank you. I have to turn my lights on. That helps. Okay, Kyle, can you hit your light again so I can test it? All right, perfect. It's working. Very good. Kyle.
All right, I would first like to make a motion to approve waivers from the current policy 6432 to the following schools. Jefferson, Roosevelt, Strange, and Nash.
And I'll second that motion.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second on the floor, and I'd like to open this up for discussion at this point, so please hit your lights if you would, and I will get your lights. And Joanne, you are up.
I would like to separate these because some have more information than others. Some are still a work in progress, and if the person who made the motion and seconded it is willing to do that.
So you want me
to? Because each is unique.
You want me to approve one at it? You want to approve one at a time?
Right.
I guess that would be fine. We can go with Jefferson first.
Okay. And we have a motion and an amendment to the motion. So we need to, and that's fine with Kyle. And it's friendly,
yep.
So it's fine.
The motion is only we'll Jefferson now.
Very good. So we'll move forward, and we'll start with Jefferson. And I'm looking for lights.
I have my, or I did. You just turned it off.
Okay, you're back on. Go, Joanne.
I've heard that Jefferson has a space problem, but it's also a school where a lot of the people do not come in and get their kids registered. It's very much in flux. And I'm wondering if there are any extra classrooms and if you have any additional information since it was sent to us earlier today.
And who would you like to address the
question
to?
Well, actually, it's through Dr. Hancock.
All right.
I think I'm probably looking at Dr. Williams.
We'll let Dr. Hancock handle that then. Thank you.
Yes, he probably needs to come up for this.
Thank you.
Yes, I will ask Floyd. Mm-hmm.
Welcome,
Dr.
Floyd.
Dr. Williams.
Dr. Williams, welcome.
First of all, Dr. Williams, I'll talk while you're coming. A number of these children have not been assigned to a room, yet schools are in different places right now, and probably they are still listed as unassigned because of the uncertainty surrounding this. First of all, if they actually have numbers that are total, what is the greatest need there?
Okay, excuse me. Number one, Joanne or Ms. Tubby, you are correct. Due to the influx of what we have as far as what the policy may be, some principals have unassigned some of their students based until we get certain which way the policy will go. I will ask the principal of Jefferson to come up, Ms. Walsh, at this time, and she can explain some questions that you may have.
Well, just a brief explanation because sure. I'm wondering where we're at.
Does she want to come right here?
There's a place Kathy? There.
Ms. Walsh.
And I'll chime in as well.
All right, welcome. We look forward to a brief explanation, if you would please. Thank you.
Currently, Jefferson has, as of the end of the day today, an enrollment of 283 students. That puts, do you want a list by grade level as far as how many students are each grade level? Or
just update us on the total.
A quick update? Sure. Right now, we have 31 students in our, or 32 in our pre-K class, 46 in our kindergarten that has divided between three teachers. So currently that puts about 15 or 16 students per classroom. Our kindergarten enrollment rises immensely that week that school starts because that's when they all come in and enroll. Okay. So we like to start that out low. Our first and second grade combined enrollment at this point is 80 students divided between three teachers. So that fluctuates right now around 27 per class. 26 or 27. Our third and fourth grade students total 40, 60.
What's second grade?
Second grade students are 33. The reason we go with a multi-age is if we have a second grade class, one grade level at 33 students, and we cap it at 25 for a straight class, that leaves six additional students. And the decision of which are the six students that we adjust to put in a multi-age classroom then often raises a lot of discussion among our teachers and among our parents. It leaves a second grade teacher working in isolation with just a straight second grade class, only one person that would have a multi-age 1-2 class. And therefore, the teachers have preferred to stay together with the three multi-age classes, so then they plan together and they work their activities together as well.
And that's for grades?
That's for first and second grade. Those are multi-age classrooms, and there are three of those. And right now, those enrollments are hovering around 26 and 27. About 10:30 this morning, we had about 272 students, and at 3:30 this afternoon, we had 283. So we had 11 enroll between about 10:30 this morning and 3 o'clock this afternoon. We could lose a few again tomorrow. It continues to fluctuate that much every day leading up to the start of the school year. Our 3-4 multi-age classes, again, we have three of those. And those enrollments right now are sitting at about 24 per class. And then our fifth grade is a straight fifth grade with 47 students.
Two
fifth grade classes with a total of 47 students enrolled at this time.
At this time?
Yes.
Quite honestly, I think we're going to have to allow the administration to work with this and the ever-changing figures on it and try to keep those class sizes down as much as possible because they're dealing with multi-age plus the type of school.
Yeah, as of right now at Jefferson, art and music is on a cart. There are no more classrooms available. Mm-hmm. If we needed another classroom, we'd have to look at our pre-K classroom, and I hate to do that because those little ones then would have to move out. So,
well, there is space elsewhere in the district, but I know no one likes to move once mm-hmm. they have their classroom set up. I was one of those people at one time. It's a pain mm-hmm. at the last, but if it has to be done, it may have to be done for the sake of the education of kids.
She's using my mic. I can't. I just have a question. Okay. So
So could you just, you threw up a lot of numbers.
Sure.
Can you just share with me the highest class size you would have?
Excuse me, I just want to, I know this is difficult, but if you can just lean into the mic, just so everyone out there can hear. Yeah, I know, I know. I think she can actually turn that mic on in front of her if she just presses the button.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, it'll be live.
Wasn't sure if it was.
There you go, but thank you. And Joanne, I would request the same of you, if you, your voice is kind of soft, so if you could just get on top of that mic so everybody can hear you. Appreciate it.
Sure. So my question again, if everyone can hear me, thought I had a big mouth. Kathy, can you just share with us the largest class size that you would have in a multi-age setting? What would be the largest, based on your numbers you just gave? I thought I heard 24, but I just want to be sure my numbers were right.
Right now, we'd probably be looking at about 27 in one of our first, second grade multi-age classrooms. We have two at 26, and we'd have one at 27.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
And that could fluctuate. Mm-hmm. That could change tomorrow.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay, so this is as of this minute.
Correct.
And that's why you're asking for the waiver, because if you need to go with what you have right now, this is what you would have.
Correct.
Thank you.
All right. Any other questions for Ms. Walsh or Mr. Dr. Williams? Any other question? Do I see lights here? I don't see any lights, so I'm taking that we've had. Everybody's got their questions answered. Thank you very much, Dr. Williams. Thank you, Ms. Walsh. You might want to just stay with us. Thank you. I appreciate that. Okay. So we are on Jefferson currently. Do you want to go through the list, and do you want to check off? Do you want to vote individually? I want to know what the process is.
At this point, Rebecca,
because
we
of the
have
motion?
To vote individually
okay.
because of the motion.
Okay. So we have Jefferson up, and so we need to decide if we are going to approve a waiver or not approve the waiver for Jefferson Elementary. Excuse me, this is all new to us because we've never been here and doing this before, so bear with me on it. So all those in favor of approving the waiver for Jefferson, please indicate with, let's do a roll call vote. Stacy, please, we'll do that.
Mrs. Taube?
Yes.
Mr. Flood?
Yes.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Ms. Stevens?
Yes, and I'm looking forward to keeping a close eye on those larger class sizes, and we will get a follow-up report, I know, and with the first week of school and first Friday count, I know you'll be looking at that very closely for us, so I appreciate that. Thank
yes.
you. Okay, the next school on the list to for the, did we have someone mention the next school?
Roosevelt.
All right.
Coming up.
And I see, Kyle, you have your light on, so if you'd like to speak to that.
Well, I was actually just going to make the motion to approve a waiver for Roosevelt Elementary.
Second.
We have a question from Joanne. We have a motion and a second on the floor for Roosevelt Elementary. Joanne, your question, please. And I see we have the principal from, I am so sorry, please remind me of your name. Nola. Thank you very
much. Nola.
Ratliff. Thank you. I know you.
I just
don't have your name on the tip of my tongue. So, Joanne, would you please address your question?
You have a school in a school, and you have the enrichment program, and then you have the regular boundary school.
That's correct.
Are you figuring these separately? Are you using the enrichment for overflow? Are you anticipating having a split for the enrichment program?
No, I'm
program?
Not. The enrichment are right on task with numbers.
What are the numbers for enrichment, please?
Is it on?
Just talking. Pardon?
Yeah, just talk.
It's wireless, so you can pull it towards you.
And up is on.
Okay. Pardon?
Down is off.
All right.
What was the question regarding enrichment?
The enrichment. I'd like to know the sizes of the enrichment classes.
Right now in second grade, 27, and third grade, 26, and fourth grade, 15, and in fifth grade, 22.
There are criteria for entering into the enrichment program, and I'm wondering why with 15 in fourth grade, I know in the past they have had multi-age, why we're looking at 27 in second and 26 in third with 15 in fourth.
Well, that's what we have looked at. We planned at grade level. I like the second grade, third grade, the fourth grade, and the fifth grade, and we staffed by grade level.
Is that because of international baccalaureate?
No, it had nothing to do with anything. All it had to do was this teacher said, let's go grade level, and it was the parents had asked. They really wanted grade level, so I stuck by the grade level, and that's what I did. And I know fourth grade is low. 2 years ago, I was not around during the time that recruiting for the fourth grade at that time. So I'm blaming me, actually, for the low numbers in fourth grade.
You weren't there. But how about the high number in second grade?
Well, we staffed a 30-to-1 staffing. That's what we did because that was what we did. What was given to us as a number was 30-to-1, and that's what we staffed as.
And all of these truly qualify for the program?
Absolutely.
From coming throughout the district?
Yes.
And how are your class sizes for the regular classrooms?
Extremely high. And they're high only because in the last 2 or 3 weeks, we've had ins and out that are far exceeds anything we've ever had before at Roosevelt. Our numbers are at 480 presently.
Wow. Maybe I should ask one of you to say, based on what you're looking at right now, how many extra teachers do you think you need and how many can you accommodate?
We've provided Ms. Ratliff with an additional teacher
right. So
far.
And we're looking at the numbers as presented to you by Dr. Williams, but what we're asking is let's wait till third Friday count because we know the ins and outs of the students that are there. We're looking at maybe 32 in fifth grade presently right now, but we don't know who's going to walk in that door. But based on what Dr. Williams and Dr. Hancock has presented to us, we're going to wait till third Friday, and they said bring the numbers back. We're looking at presently, I had asked for possibly additional K-1 position, looking at kindergarten and first grade, only because right now those are the lower grades, and we like the lower grades. But
right. We traditionally have.
Pardon?
That's what we have traditionally
yes. Targeted,
first of all.
But yet and still that...
How many of those 480 are 4K kindergarten?
35.
And so
I don't think we even counted the 4K as a part of the 480.
You didn't?
No.
Well, if you only
count.
Have 16 teachers, you're way above the staffing level of 25-to-1.
Just to make clear that last year, she was staffed on 16 individual teachers. This year, we've provided her with two additional teachers. Mm-hmm. So her staffing has increased from 16 to 18.
So that's not reflecting what we were provided.
So if you give an overall ratio, right now she should be right at, when you look at building, about 25 students in the classroom, and that's not including the K-4. We're talking about K-5 through 5th.
Well, if she truly has 480, which we're not certain of yet, it would be closer to 19 teachers. And can she accommodate it?
Presently, we do. That's the K-1.
Right.
But anything above and over and beyond the K-1, we're saying just wait. Let's wait and see.
I understand that.
Okay.
Sorry. There's a correction. That 400 was including the preschool. So that
was
the pre-K. Yes, the pre-K was included.
Okay. Okay. Thank you for clarifying that.
So you probably have a few extra teachers there, a couple or one?
Pardon?
For your 4K, you probably, that's not listed in what I'm looking at.
No.
I guess we want to see what actually materializes, but keep on top of it.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Uh-huh.
Right. And just to clarify, like Principal Ratliff stated, is that we'll look at it third Friday or sooner, once the individual bodies come into the door, once the students walk in. Mm-hmm. Dr. Hancock has done a great job of making me aware to make a note of hot spots and to work with those individuals on making that occur. The other thing that we want to be conscious of, too, is that we want to try to wait as much as possible so that when we move teachers, if we have to move teachers around, that we're not overstaffing or anything of that nature.
Right. We have 2 weeks.
Thank you. I see yes. Bob has his light on, so Bob.
I have a sheet in front of me that says 8/19/2013 confidential with all the teachers enlisted here. And I see for Roosevelt we only have 16 teachers, but you're telling me we have 18 teachers in? Okay. We hired two more today? It's just that this is not up to date, and that's what we're looking
Bob,
at.
Bob, may I have some assistance with that question, Dr. Hancock? Yeah. Chris is indicating that he's got additional information
Madam President,
on that.
I just want to clarify a couple things. First, going back to Joanne's, when you asked about the 34 in Roosevelt, remember that's a half day, so it wouldn't be necessarily two teachers. It'd be two half classes or half days of 17 each. That's why I separated those out. And Mr. Nuzzo, the report that you were given, this reflects what's input in Zanglin, our student information system. So a couple weeks back when we expanded to the 25-to-1, that's where an additional staff member was allocated for Roosevelt, and we're working to, I believe, get another one. Now, this only reflects if the teacher allocation was created in there. So that's why you would see some students unassigned in these roles in here. And also, it's to caution you, yes, this was accurate as of 11 a.m. today, but this is a highly moving target right now, as Ms. Walsh already elaborated. So yes, 16 are in the system now. I don't know where Ms. Ratliff is in the process of the hiring piece.
Okay. She was approved.
But we need to know those allocations.
Yeah, but again, she has to put that person in the system and then allocate students for it. So,
you know,
does that help, Bob?
Well, it helps only so much as that if we go through every school and we're finding out that we're shooting at moving targets here, one of the things that I'm convinced of is the administration is doing absolutely the best job they possibly can to make this work, and I think most of the board members agree with that. That, you know, I don't know that we can do anything today other than grant the variances that the schools requested. I don't think we want to change the policy. I'm not for changing the policy, okay? But I think we need to say, administration, you're doing the job, and I don't know that we can go through these things and add any value with analyzing every school. I think we should go through and grant the variances they have requested and follow up at the next board meeting and the following board meeting what administration is doing. I think that would make more sense than doing this, because one of the things we have a problem with is we don't have any more money to do things with. Maybe we're going to find some more. I don't think so. There are places where we can get the money. I'd rather not go there. I'll do whatever you guys want to do here, but I think going through each school and bringing each principal up here and seeing what we've gotten from the first two principals, they are on top of the project. It's a moving target, and it's going to be very, very hard to hit it right now. In fact, it's impossible. No, it's not a motion. It's a political statement.
I appreciate that. We'll move on. Thank you, Nola, very much. So given what the motion was, is we were going to look at each
I would like to
variance.
Mark each one.
So let's move on to the next one then. Oh, excuse me. See, thank you. This is new. This is very different. So thanks for keeping me on track. Okay, so we have Roosevelt applying for the waiver, and all those in favor, actually, we'll have you do the roll call votes. We'll do them individually. For Roosevelt, yes, we did.
Yeah.
That's okay, so do I. Stacey, would you help us with
that? May I make an amendment, a waiver, with the understanding that reports come back to us? And I think that's
the reports will be coming back to the board. Absolutely.
Okay,
updates continuously. I think even as the numbers change, you're giving us that information. So if you can keep that coming to us, that's very helpful. Okay, Stacy?
Mrs. Taube?
Yes.
Mr. Flood?
Yes.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Ms. Stevens?
Yes. All right, let's move ahead to the next school, which is Curtis Strange. I have lights with Kyle and then Joanne. Kyle?
I'll make the motion to approve a waiver for Strange Elementary.
And can I get a second, please?
I'll second that.
All right, I have a second and then discussion. Joanne, remember to stay on top of your mic, please.
Did that change today?
Excuse me, just let me take a minute. John Barden is the principal over at Curtis Strange. So thank you and welcome. Thank you for coming. Okay, now go ahead. Please proceed.
Over the last week, we've had lots of our lower class sizes grow and some of our largest class sizes decline. So we're pretty happy with the way things are going right now. We do have one split class. We are going to have that class at 25. It helps to alleviate really large numbers in third and fourth grade. The fifth grade, I'm happy to say, is we've lost six kids over the course of the last week, which means that with a few more kids, that is our only class size that right now looks to be over the policy.
How many teachers do you have right now? Because you mentioned a third, fourth split.
19.
Instead of 18.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And I see.
Thank you.
He answered your question. So we're good to go on that. Any other questions from board members? All right. If not, then we will. We have a motion and a second, so we're voting. Are we approved to approve the waiver for Curtis Strange Elementary? Again, roll call vote, please, Stacy. Thank you, John.
Mrs. Taube?
Yes.
Mr. Flood?
Yes.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Ms. Stevens?
Yes. Okay, and next on the list is... Kyle?
I would make a motion to approve a waiver for Nash Elementary.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. And do we have any questions? I know Mr. Pitts was here the other night and informed the board on some of the positive things that are happening based on the CESA stuff. So welcome back, Mr. Pitts. And Joanne has a question for you.
Did you ask your parents to sign if they were willing to have their children in the multi-age classes or the straight class?
Well, we presented at two different PTA meetings prior to establishing our class lists. All of our first grade students will be on the next gen wing. For our second and third grade parents, we sent something home inviting them to request. And as of now, we have a waiting list of 30 that would like to be in that we don't have room for. So. For second and third grade students, the inquiry went out to parents. We received more of a response for wanting to be in on the next gen wing than we had room for. But it wasn't presented as an option to first grade. All of our first grade students are on the next gen wing.
Are you flexible enough if you need to change?
In what way?
Well, all first graders, there's still a wide spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
And to meet the needs of those.
Well, that's,
I mean, you may have kids in first grade who are reading third and fourth grade, and you may have some who are just learning the basics.
And that is exactly what the purpose of the whole next generation movement is, Ms. Talby. It really is. It's designed to meet the needs, the specific needs of those students that might be behind the bell curve as well as those that are in the 99th percentile. And that is exactly what we intend to do. And there will be, I speculate, huge value in those first grade students. I think there will be huge value in those first grade students that are behind, benefiting from having the same team of three teachers working with them for 3 years. I think there's huge potential benefits in that. So. I guess if you're asking me if I would be open to the idea of creating another just exclusive first grade class with first graders that by your definition, you feel would better benefit by that? I would have to say at this point, no, I wouldn't be willing to do that because I feel that strongly that this will be better for those students.
I'm inclined to approve the waiver because I know you have laid the groundwork with the addition that you come before the board, say after the third quarter, and let us know what the progress and some data on it. Mm-hmm. Because the data is some of the research you're actually doing right now. There's
exactly.
some research, but mm-hmm. there's
And
not
I will
a
say
lot.
That the data that's coming out of West Allis right now and the other districts in our state that are doing this is very encouraging. Very
well,
encouraging.
You've been on the cutting edge ever since you opened there.
Thank you.
How much room do you have in your building if you had to create another classroom?
Well, we could potentially create another classroom if we had to. We have one room that is primarily being used for occupational therapy, physical therapy, kids that need, you know, to be pulled out for various services such as that. And that could potentially be utilized as a classroom, and those services could take place elsewhere. So if it was a total necessity, we have the room to do it.
Your projections for fifth grade are rather high.
Actually, we're allocated another fifth grade position. So
okay.
right now we have sizes of 24 and 25.
That's great. It's not what our
Four
paper
classes.
Is showing.
Right.
So it's changed.
Yeah.
This really was not up to date. It was sent out today, but it's not up to date.
As it stands right now.
But that's excellent.
Our kindergarten numbers, which have been growing in the last week, they're at about 23. On the next gen wing, we are looking at an average class size of 24 when you take into account the fact that there's about 20, or I should say 73 and 74 kids in a team of three. So we're looking at, you know, right around, okay, which would be, I guess, more like 24. And then fifth grade now is at 24 and 25, and fourth grade is the same. And we have one second grade class that is not on the next gen wing right now. They're at 22. And we have two third grade classes that are at 23 that are not a part of the next gen wing.
Okay. Thank you.
I just want to clarify too, Ms. Tubby. You mentioned the report not being up to date, but just a point of clarity is that we authorized for the principals to hire additional staff when we found we're needed. There's still a hiring process in which that has to occur. So just as a result of that, those individual new teacher positions won't be posted on this sheet yet. So just to make you aware.
Thank you. Appreciate that. I just want to move on to Tamara. She has her light on, and then I just have a quick comment. I don't see, if I see any other lights, we'll move forward then. Tamara?
I just want to congratulate you, Mr. Pitts, again, for doing such a great job over at Nash. I just have a quick question. You said there were 30-something students or parent families that were on a waiting list for Next Generation.
That is correct.
I hate that kids can't get the opportunity. So are you looking at any opportunity for them to get some type of get in there somehow?
Yeah. Well, Ms. Coleman, when you look at the way that we are implementing this Next Gen initiative, it's happening in stages. And we had 25 teachers that participated in a summer book study planning session. Now, nine of those teachers were on the Next Gen wing, okay, which means that a large number of those teachers are going to be employing many of the same practices, even though they are not fully implementing Next Gen. So you can expect that in every corner of Nash, there will be better personalized learning practices taking place. It will be fully implemented, however, along with the multi-age component on the Next Gen wing.
So we're getting some piece of it indirectly.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
And I guess my observation from the other evening is from listening to what you had presented to the committee meetings was very insightful, and I thank you for that. Sharing the fact that the training is in place for the personalized learning, mm-hmm. and I do agree strongly that that is the direction that we all need to go, and I think technology is going to help us get there faster. But I do agree it takes some training, just like it does for the staff and that buy-in piece, too. So thank you. I know you've worked on it a number of years, and it's nice to see it come to fruition through the phases and the planning that you have done with not only you, but I know your staff is, awesome with working with you on that. So thank you.
It's all attributed to the staff, really.
Great.
Is.
Thank you so much. Okay, so we have a motion and a second. I don't see any other lights. So I'd like to take a roll call vote now on the waiver for Nash Elementary to approve their waiver for this year. Stacy?
Mrs. Taube?
Yes.
Mr. Flood?
Yes.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Ms. Stevens?
Yes.
Thank you. We won't
You're
let
welcome.
You down.
Thank you. Next, school, please, and a motion. I need that. Are you? We got them all. No. Wait, Southport. All right. We were going through them individually, so we have South. Wait, we have. Put my glasses on. Okay, so I need a motion for Forest Park, please.
So moved.
And a second. Very good.
All right, this
question lights for questions. And we have Luann Rohde joining us from Forest Park. Joanne, shoot with your questions, please.
Well, I think she can tell us if there's been a change, because I know you have a...
What changes?
That is probably the fastest way to get to it, because I see you have a 4-5 split still.
I still do, yes. 4-5. I have a 4-5 multi-age. I have no changes. My 4-5 multi-age has 26 in it. My fourth grades are at 28 and 29, and my fifth grade is at 28 and 27.
It's a lot of students.
Uh-huh.
What would happen if you were allotted another teacher based on need?
Then I would be able to split the fourth and the fifth, and that would give me fourth grade at 23 each and fifth grade at 23 each.
I would like to make the recommendation that administration closely look at that.
It's
their assessment of district needs.
I have some other lights on, so I'm going to move forward. And we have Tamara, please.
I made a motion. Was there already one?
Well,
okay, fine.
Excuse me. Let me correct myself. I didn't realize that was a motion. I thought that was just a statement. So
no.
We have a motion and a second. And you want?
We're in a motion now.
Right.
Okay.
So do we want an amendment? Are you requesting an amendment to the motion? To the motion?
The motion was to grant a waiver?
Yes.
Yes.
Or in discussion. So we have to vote on that before we can move forward.
No, I can always amend it.
Well, you can request.
I'll try to make an amendment. Okay, fine. We'll see.
I think it's a good idea, wise to go through the discussion, and we can come back to it. Tamara, please.
And maybe I'm not sure if this is for Dr. Williams or for finance, but I'm just curious if we were to go, I mean, I think we need to go through our budget projections first, because I'm just concerned from a budgetary standpoint, where does that leave us if we add an additional teacher at Stoker? I mean, at Forest Park, excuse me, my old school. I am concerned about 28 and 29 and 28 and 27, but where does that leave us? Because we still have some other schools that we need to look at, and we may have even higher class sizes. So I think we need to look at each individual school before we start talking about adding teachers.
Okay, and I appreciate that, and I'm going to call on Sharonda at this point, and then we'll follow with Dr. Williams. Sharonda?
Yeah.
Thank you.
We have been on the phone all day with principals looking at number and adding. We are still working with the first 19 that you approved to get it to 25-1 as the numbers are coming in, because when you first approved that, the numbers weren't high, because remember that was back in July. Now that students are coming in, we've pretty much given out all of those FTE. So before we add any FTE, there may be some shifting. So we really wouldn't add any additional FTEs. And when you do get to the budget, when we start talking about the budget, you will notice that there's been a line item that we're requesting from the board for a contingency pool, because we know that the numbers are fluctuating so much, we have to have a contingency in place to address any issues by Third Friday that we need to add. So if we need to add positions, if we have that contingency, we most certainly can take care of those spots.
Thank you, and I appreciate you clarifying that for us, Sharonda, because as usual, when our third Friday counts, or even on the first week of school, if we have a large group showing up, we have to have money set aside. So that's nothing unusual for where we're at. It's just from what you explained to me, I know when we met also is a clarification piece of how many people we bring back. We want to make sure that we can fully employ them for the rest of the year. So we want to we're kind of erring on the conservative side, but we don't want to leave you stuck in a position where if you need another teacher and we can figure it out, we want to get that done, because we want to make the classroom a priority and work through these things one school at a time. And we do want to keep that policy in place. So we're going to be working very closely. I know administration is going to be looking at this, and we have a contingency to look at additional staffing if we need it. So I see, Kyle, you have your light on, and then Mary, and then tomorrow you'll be on your second. Kyle?
All right. With the four waivers that we have approved so far, we have reduced the cost of this whole policy by $800,000 with those four waivers that we just approved. I would urge this board not to approve any more waivers. Forest Park in particular, we as a board did receive many emails and phone calls from different teachers and parents from Forest Park asking us not to approve a waiver for this school. I would urge the board not to approve any more waivers, and I cannot support this waiver.
Okay, we have Mary up, and I'm sorry, did you want to, Dr. Williams?
I just want to respond just to one thing, Kyle, but, excuse me, Mr. Flood, but by us not, by us granting the waivers, we didn't save $800,000. We prevented ourselves from finding $800,000. So I just want to clarify that there's not anything such as a savings, but we would have to go out into the budget and find ways to come up with that money.
Yeah, he did. Thank you for catching that. You said that backwards. Little faux pas there. Okay, then we have Mary up, and after that, Tamara, and then that's your second, and then Joanne, that'll be your second. So Mary,
okay,
you're first.
Thank you. I just wanted to emphasize, we've heard from five elementary principals already about the fluctuation that's going on in their buildings. And by our granting a waiver, we give them the ability to come back and ask for another teacher if they need to, by combining classes if they need to, depending on what students walk in the door before the day school starts and before the third Friday. I would like us to grant these waivers for that reason. I think they are the ones in the building with the support of their parents and their staff. They're going to be able to make the decisions of what we need. I don't think we need a motion to raise a staffing number at this point in time, because we don't know for sure that that's going to be the case. Maybe she will need one less teacher and some other building will need a teacher. We need that flexibility, and we need to trust our principals and our administrators to know that flexibility. I am for granting the waivers. I disagree with Mr. Flood. I think that we need our principals and staffs in those buildings the freedom to make those decisions for their buildings and their students. And they are much more in touch with what's going on there than we are. And we have 22,000 students in the building. So if you get 20 phone calls, we have 22,000 students, over 30,000 parents. And we have to look at the big picture. That's our job, to look at the big picture and then make a hard decision and to weigh everybody's input. So please grant the waivers so they have the freedom to start school with a staff that's assigned. Teachers are being reassigned daily. Today, teachers were reassigned to different grades and different rooms. So please give them the ability to do this so they can start school and students and parents can know where their students are going to be, who their teacher's going to be, and that things are going to get going in the way that they should for the most success for our students.
All right. Thank you, Mary. And Tamara, you are up for the second term. Okay. Great. We have Joanne for your second, followed by Bob, and then for his first, and Carl for his first. Go ahead, Joanne. Second.
I have no need to speak on this one, but I do want to continue with the process. I'm opposed to what Mr. Flood said. I think we need to look at some of these right now.
Okay. Bob, you are up then, and followed by Carl.
Mary said what I was saying before more eloquently than I did, but that's that. Mary and I have the same thought pattern in there. Obvious for Forest Park, it looks to me like you're going to add another teacher. You need to add another teacher. It's very obvious. I think administration is saying the same thing. I look in the budget, we have room there to add some more teachers. So I don't think I don't think administration, I think we give administration a license and then check administration in 2 weeks to see what they've done. If they've done some things badly, they know that we will not be nice to them. So I...
Well...
We'll still be nice.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Bob. Carl, you're first, and then you're followed by Kyle for a second.
Man, just as I thought that after the last four votes, this was the most unified we were going to be in the last 4 months. Don't get that one, Bill. just for clarification, I'm looking at this list here, and obviously what's popping out at me right now is the fourth and fifth grade. We're looking at 27, 28. If this waiver isn't granted, does that mean we're shutting the door on bringing in another teacher for the record?
Mm-mm. No.
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 No. Yeah. No. Okay. Well, I'm just asking procedurally because, okay.
Good right. question.
Okay.
That is
absolutely.
A good question.
Just
very good.
For clarification.
Absolutely. Good mm-hmm. question for clarification. Yeah. And then we have Kyle, and this is your second, and then we will go to the vote, unless Joanne wants to offer that friendly amendment.
I just remind the board that this is a waiver to approve a multi-age classes over 20 students, and we were contacted by teachers at Forest Park, including multi-age teachers, who asked us not to approve a waiver for more than 20 students in their multi-age class. And I know we all got that email. I know I asked permission to forward it to the rest of the board for one of the teachers, and I did. So I know we all got those emails, and the teachers have requested us not to approve more than 20 students. So I just remind the board of that.
Was it not just one teacher, right?
It's two. There were two.
How many? Can you say that in the microphone so we can all hear, please? Thank you.
There were three Forest Park teachers who contacted us.
Okay. Thank you, Kyle, for reminding us all. And I'm going to stop by Joanne really quick for the amendment, for the potential of the amendment to that, but then we have to move forward and vote on this.
I'm not willing to lock it in stone because the kids have not appeared, although at Forest Park they're pretty stable. And yes. So as we get closer, my feeling is that definitely Forest Park should receive high consideration.
Okay. All right. I know we need to move on, and we are going to do that. They've stated that. So we have a motion on the floor with a second to...
I just need one point of clarity, a number.
Good point. Okay. I'm sorry, I missed your light. Tamara, point of clarity?
So it sounds like we're going to be adding a teacher over at Forest Park. And if my numbers are correct, when we add that teacher, there will be a split, 4-5 split. She can bring it down to 23 students. So we're talking.
No.
Is that what you
said? No. If I get another teacher, I won't have any splits.
There we
I
go.
Have 3-4, 3-5.
Wonderful.
No multi-age classrooms.
So it sounds like we're okay. All right. Beautiful. So your teachers and your parents are being going to probably get what they want if we add another teacher based on our existing numbers.
We have to look at the budget.
All right, well, thank you for clarifying. So we'll be looking for that as the numbers roll out. All right, so we have a motion to approve the waiver for Forest Park. Roll call vote, please. Stacy.
Mrs. Taube.
No.
Mr. Flood?
No.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
No.
Ms. Stevens?
Yes. Okay. It's a 4-3. Motion carries. Okay. We have... Who's up next on the list? Grant Element? Do we have Grant for a waiver?
I have some questions on some other schools.
Yep, we're going through alphabetically, so please join us. Okay. Would you please, since you're new to the district, will you please introduce yourself to, not to the district, but to Grant, please. Thank you, I appreciate. Try that again.
Shebaniah Muhammad, principal of Grant Elementary.
Thank you. It's great to have you here. Okay, so we have Grant Elementary, and can I get a motion?
Second.
And we've got a motion and a second for Grant Elementary discussion, and I see Joanne has her light on, so we'll move right forward on that.
Grant is very difficult to project because kids will walk in. Right now, it looks like you could be overstaffed from what I'm looking at. How many students do you think you have as of today?
Roughly 250 students as of today. We've had students actually today in, like three new students come in across grades, as students leave, so the mobility is high. So to say what it would be exactly on the first day of school, I couldn't.
Personally, I'm not willing to grant a waiver looking at the figures because I think instead of having splits, you could probably have straights. You might be one school that they'll be looking at when school starts and saying you're a little bit overstaffed.
But just one thing, Ms. Tubby, just for clarity, though, is that that's why during the third Friday we go and take a look. So if he is overstaffed, then during that third Friday, then that could be that the school like Forest Park that just came up that we're looking at right now that needs another teacher, it could come from there. And so I'm just making you aware of that.
You're making us aware of it, but I don't think this school needs a waiver at present.
Well,
Point of clarification, you're saying you don't believe it needs a waiver, period, because they're already covered? Is that?
They're adequately covered based on the amount of students that are currently projected. They have 17 teachers. He has not assigned some of the students.
No, I need to clarify that. That was one of the notes pages on the report. One of the reasons why this is a moving target is that the system has the ability for an administrator to create a placeholder teacher. I put that in the notes page if you just happen to miss that portion. So somebody could place those students in there as they're moving them around. So, again, and that's why I specifically pointed out Grant. They have 17 listed in this report, but some are just temporary placeholders while they look at the class allocation. So I believe it's 11 that they
only
have.
It's 11 authorized teachers that Grant has. It's not 17. It's 11.
How many? Well,
11.
I see 17 teachers.
Well, but what he's saying, those are placeholders. Those are just ambiguous individuals that are there just to hold positions. So
right.
It's only 11. So it's not 17.
Correct. Yeah, 17
so
is
we're not looking at accurate figures when we're discussing this. We have to be filled in. With 11 at the max, even 25 to 1 would be 225 students, and we're already over that. So how many teachers do you think you have right now?
I have 11 classroom teachers. The 17 includes my special ed teachers and my library media specialist. So you got those in at 17.
No,
now, you've included them, but I am betting that a lot of the principals have not done that, and so we're not uniform at what we're looking at.
Let me just clarify. I'm sorry, Ms. Tubby.
Dr. Williams,
that the report that you have is specifically classroom teachers. It's not librarians. It's not special education teachers. It's just classroom teachers. I'm informing you that this report, as he mentioned, are some placeholder individuals that are in there. In his case, he actually has 11 teachers that is assigned classroom teachers in his building, 11.
And again, the system, without getting too technical, the system allows to, in the schedule, create a spot just to put students in as you're looking at some of the student data. So, again, the big cautions with this report, on why we presented it and the cautionary that when you reference it, there are a lot of variations and a lot of freedoms that administrators have in applying this data. So, you know, I didn't want to give you a report filled with a bunch of errors. This is the report as of when it was requested, but please keep in mind there are a lot of these variations. So
it shows there are variations in the report, and some schools are apples, some are oranges, some are bananas, and some are avocados.
Here we go with the fruit thing again. Okay, Bob is next up. Followed Bob, and then by Tamara.
The reason you're asking for variances, it looks like you do have three split classes here. One has 26 in it, one has 28, and one has 25. Is that the reason you're asking for variances?
Yes.
And if we don't grant those variances, you're going to have to add more teachers there.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we have Tamara, followed by Kyle, followed by Joanne for the second time.
Can you just explain, so you have 11 teachers, you'll have three split. What about your fifth grade? Are there any fifth grade splits, or is it just third, fourth?
It's just third, fourth.
So no other grade levels?
No other grade level split after looking at the school.
There's a 2-3 in there.
No, we had to change it after looking at all the numbers. And saying what would be best for Grant Elementary with our numbers, combining, making a 3-4 split, actually lowered the numbers instead of doing a 4-5 or a 2-3. So that's our lower split to accommodate the number of our staffs and to make sure we fall in line with policy.
And so the highest split class would be 28 as of this second. That could definitely change. Is that what I'm understanding?
Yes. And they're actually down, just looking at numbers from today, to 25 with our mobility.
Oh, so we're down to 25 three split classes.
Correct.
So that the numbers keep changing, so it could really go down even more.
That's a possibility.
Or go up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
That's why we're on top. They're on top of watching the numbers, yeah. Right? And watch them roll in and roll out. It's
yes.
Kind of like being at the lake. All right, let's see. Who do I have next? I have Kyle, followed by Joanne for the second time.
I may say this every single time. All of the pro multi-age research that you can find says that class sizes should be 19, 20, or lower. Pro multi-age research. Now, I agreed to those original four waivers because the three had space issues that they needed to resolve. And NASH has massive community support for their Next Generation program. I cannot support any more waivers because all of our questions here are about, okay, so how many more teachers do we have to add? Okay, what's your class? This is about students, okay? And the research says that if you have higher than 20 in a multi-age class, some even says higher than 19 in a multi-age class, that it's harmful to students. And I'm voting for students, so I cannot support any more waivers, and I hope that you will all join me in that.
Thank you. All right, we have a motion and a second to approve. Oh, you did have your light on for a second turn. I'm sorry, Joanne. Go right ahead.
In your count, are you including special ed students who are included in the classroom with inclusion?
Yes, all my students are in inclusion class at Grant.
That's the procedure we generally follow, and I know you have moved from secondary to elementary, and I'm not going to say down, but it's different.
Mm-hmm.
I will say that if we reach 20 in every split and we had to have 30 or 31 in the straights, I would be opposed to it. And so I like the intent of the policy as we passed it. I know schools like Jefferson and Grant have a lot more movement in and out. And for that reason, they probably need to be staffed at a little lower ratio to deal with all the socioeconomic problems that they're dealing with in behavior. But it doesn't mean that we want to pack in students on the shelves and some of our other schools that have less movement in and out either. But I believe sometimes we need to give a little extra consideration to try to make it work for schools like Jefferson and Grant and Central City especially.
Okay, thank you, Joanne. Tamara, I saw your light was on.
Thank you, Rebecca. You know, for the first time in a long time, I'm going to agree with Joanne.
Well, wonderful.
Because, you know, of course we want lower class sizes all the way across the board. And I know our focus tonight seems to be on just multi-age, but I would like us to continue to look at all grades, all class sizes. Regardless if it's 20 or 25, we want all class sizes lowered. So, I know, again, I know our focus is on multi-age, but Mr. Flood, those studies that you're looking at, I see the same studies on regular classes and straight classes. The class sizes are, should be lower. So that should be our focus, is on lower class sizes, period. And, you know, so I just wanted to make that point to you. I hope that the board is looking at that across, the, across, not just in multi-age. And yeah, Joanne, I think we should be looking at all schools, not just certain schools.
Thank you. Bob, I see you have your light on.
Yeah, I'm going to agree with Joanne, too, because this grant, I believe that that's one place where we don't want to short the number of teachers we've got. Grant, we need to put pressure on Grant to perform, and I don't know that having high numbers of kids in the classroom are going to make it happen. So I think we definitely, you're going to probably have to add another teacher here. And but I'm not going to make that decision for administration. I think administration knows that, and they would add that teacher there anyway.
Thank you, Bob. Kyle, your second turn.
Granting waivers does not stop us from hiring teachers. It actually requires us to hire another teacher or two. Ms. Coleman, yes, we all class sizes should be lower. But multi-age is a very different environment that especially requires lower class size. So don't say everything, because multi-age, we especially need to look at making sure that it's low enough so that it does not hurt students, which is what this will do. It will hurt students. I know a student from Forest Park, which is now a lost cause, but from Forest Park who wanted to be homeschooled when he heard we were going to change the policy. He asked his mom, can I be homeschooled now? That's an issue. Students, parents, teachers see that these high class sizes and multi-age isn't working. But apparently, other than me, this board is willing to keep doing that.
Okay.
And I have an issue with that.
Okay. Thank you, Kyle. We understand where you're coming from. And I think that, as I've explained to you, and many times in my own experience in a multi-age classroom in a 5th-6th split, like a gazillion years ago at Bose, I didn't like it at all. Okay, that was my own experience. It was a large number. It was like 30, 31 kids. And I felt very lost in that shuffle. So I totally agree with you. And I do believe the studies show over and over again that that is crucial, getting those class sizes lower, especially at the lower grades. So I think I totally wholeheartedly agree with you, but I also had an experience with one of my daughters where it worked out very well, and it was smaller, and it was set up in such a way, and I was a parent volunteer, so I was there scrutinizing, and I had a principal pick up the phone, call me up, and talk to me before they ever put my daughter in the classroom. So a lot of it is communication, getting the parents involved, making sure that the proper training is in place, because that is crucial. If you have someone that's only taught 5th grade for years and years and years, and then all of a sudden you're switching over and you're doing a 4th-5th split, but they had, you know, I mean, there's all those floating pieces, and I think that our principals have to know their staff. I've had some conversations with some of our principals, and they are open to that, and they are understanding that when they go to staff that classroom, if they have to create a split, they are doing the things that are necessary to find the right teacher for that situation. And we are going to continue to monitor this, so it's going to come back to us. So I think we need to give them a chance to figure this out to the best of their ability, but also keep in mind we have a contingency fund there to look at, so when these numbers start rolling in for real. And I totally want to make sure we support you as a first-year principal at the elementary level. Let me clarify that, because I think I made a mistake earlier. That, you know, so you know, we're cognizant of these things, and we're going to keep asking the questions. I want us to be diligent about this. So I'm done. I see that light number one is on, so I don't know if that's your light.
Yes, I just very good. Respond to Thank Mr. you. Flood. No principal have come up here arguing against lower class size. We're looking at how we can best start our school year. And whether you have 20, 19, 30 in the class, it's the quality of that teacher that matters how well that child will succeed. And that's what we are here to do, help our children succeed. That's all.
Thank you very much. Okay, so we have a motion on the floor to approve grants waiver, and we have a second, so I need a roll call vote, please. Stacy, I'm having trouble speaking tonight.
Mrs. Chavi?
No.
Mr. Flood?
Students. No.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Ms. Stevens?
Yes. What? Okay, the next. Okay. Thank you, Shab, very much. And good luck on your first year at the elementary level. I'm looking forward to that. Carbonell is the next on the list, so can I get a motion, please?
Second.
In a second, all right. And questions, please turn on your lights. And we need to move along quickly.
Mrs. Stevens?
Not you, the board. But you're, thank you.
You don't have to
I like that. Your sense of humor. Joanne?
From looking at this sheet, I have no idea how your staff is organized and how your students, because it's not broken down by classes or anything. So you're going to have to tell us what you're wanting a waiver for.
Okay. Looks like Dr. Williams just said go.
I was just going to state that when you look at the reports, you may not be aware of the report that we sent you guys, but I did meet with her earlier today, and because of the influx of changes in which that has been occurring, that is occurring, regarding with the policy, she was going through refiguring her classrooms. So that's why the report that you have, you see them just all placed in K, first, second, third, fourth, fifth. Her secretary was going through the process of redistributing them, and she'll explain.
Great. And welcome, Gabe Voltz, the principal at Greveno. I'm sorry. Just don't want to miss that. So.
It looks to me like you will be adding teachers looking at some of the grades, and it is in flux. Last year, you had a lot of multi-age grades.
What happened is we took 2-3 multi-ages this year and made straight grades out of our second and third grade. And so we had to take what was in Zangle, and so we took out the grades because we have to put them in all differently. So that's why it's not configured. So we have to reload it. So the loader wasn't run. It won't be run until the secretary is done entering the new classes and the new configurations. What I need a waiver for is... my 4-5 is all multi-age. I have 5 teachers that worked all summer. They are in agreement with this. They have, they were 4-5. They're rolling over with their fourth graders that will be fifth grade. And so my numbers in my 4-5 multi-age would be 26, 26, 26, 26, 25. The teachers are on board with this. If I did go straight grades, it would be looking at fourth grade at 30 and 31, and fifth grade at 22, 23, 23.
Oh, it almost looks like you could use another teacher in that mix.
I am, my kindergarten, it's real close, because my kindergarten has grown by about 8 students this week. That's so my kindergarten right now is looking at 29 and 30, and that's too many. If I made a multi-age, I would have to have a K-1 multi-age. And if I put that at 20, then I'm looking at 25 and I'm looking at 28 in first grade. So I'm, that is a problem.
It's a hot spot.
That's your priority.
Yep.
Very good. Okay, now I see.
And I do not have a classroom
in that 4-5. I do have one empty classroom on the first floor that if I need to add a kindergarten, I need a classroom down there for the kindergarten. I do not have any other classrooms unless I pull my art at this point and put that into the lunchroom.
Thank you. Oh, you pushed it in error. Okay, thank you. Bob?
I pushed it in error.
Okay. Mary?
I just wanted to comment on the 4-5 with looping of the same teacher. That is invaluable. Those teachers know those students. They're coming in with being able to help them move to the next level, move to the next grade while bringing in a group of students at the lower grade. So I think that's exactly the way this needs to be done. It can't always be done that way. I know that because of numbers, but this is exactly what the multi-age grouping can do, and that is allow more time for the teachers to have with individual students. So I'm really pleased to see that this is going to happen in your building.
Thank you, Mary. Kyle?
You mentioned you have one open classroom. You said that that could be used for a kindergarten class, but you said that if you aren't given this waiver, you would have a first grade class of 28. Could that additional classroom be used for another first grade class?
The waiver basically is for my 4-5. So I have no empty classrooms on the upper level. I have one empty classroom that will be, if my kindergarten continues growing, it would be a kindergarten position. Right now, my first grade with three straight first grades are at 22, 22, 23. That's my best
that's where they should be.
Numbers.
Thank
so my
you
numbers
for
in first grade are very nice. That won't if I have to make a multi-age K-1, they won't be looking so nice.
No, I don't want that for you either. So thank you for that clarification. Okay, I don't see no other lights. We have a motion. Oh, Tamara?
I just think it's interesting that your teachers are in support of this. I think that makes a difference when they're willing and ready to accept this, you know, this change.
They made a two-year commitment, basically.
That's great. I just wanted to make that comment that in addition to them rolling up with the students, which is it's great for the students, but also that they're on board with this and that they're willing to support all this. So that's great.
And again, we know the reports will come forward with how that's working for you and that's the accountability piece and all that. Okay, so we have a motion to approve the waiver over at Greveno, and we have a second and a roll call vote, please. Stacy?
Mrs. Taube?
Yes.
Mr. Flood?
No.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan? Ms. Stevens.
Yes. Motion carries. Thank you very much, and have a lovely rest of your evening. And who do we have next? Help me out, board members.
Harvey.
Harvey is up. And can I get a motion, please, in a second? We do need to move this forward quickly.
Second.
Second. All right. And it doesn't appear that we have our principal from Harvey here. So, Doctor, any questions, board members?
If she's not here, I'll take her questions.
Thank you. I don't see seeing no lights. Joanne?
I want to know what the waiver is they're requesting for Harvey.
Well, the board policy listed that any multi-age class that was over 25 students must go in front of the board for a waiver. Currently, right now, her third and fourth grade, she has a 3-4 split of 26 students in the classroom. That's why she was going in front of the board for a waiver.
Just the one.
And just 1-4.
Again, you're monitoring that very closely, and she's got the classroom space should she need to make another.
That is correct.
Classroom. So, all right. Any other questions? All right. Seeing no lights, we have a motion for to pass the waiver for Harvey. Roll call vote, please. Stacey?
Mrs. Taube?
No.
Mr. Flood?
No.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan? Ms. Stevens?
Yes. Motion passes. Okay, what is next on our list, board members? Please help me.
McKinley,
please. And then can I get a motion for McKinley?
So moved.
Okay, and a second, please, for McKinley. All right, discussion. Joanne, I see you have your lights on. Please. Questions?
There are a lot of kids there, and I just want to know why on this one.
Why does that?
Mm-hmm.
Why is there a lot of kids here?
No. Why we need the waiver?
Well, originally, excuse me.
We have a lot of kids there, but tell me about it.
I was going to say because of the quality of the school. Okay. Really,
I'm not looking at splits, so.
Okay. Just originally, she was one of those principals that just recently reconfigured her classes. So now at this point, she's went through the process and eliminated her multi-age classroom. So she's basically okay. I'm just letting you know that. Her class sizes, we have on some watch, a couple of grade levels, like her fifth grade, for example. And her K numbers are coming in a little high. But otherwise than that, she went back this morning and took her classes and were able to reconfigure them without multi-age.
So my why was not ridiculous.
No, it wasn't. Thank you.
We don't need a motion.
You don't need anything.
If she's reconfiguring everything, then we really we don't need a waiver, or is there there's no space issue there as far as your...
Hers was projected enrollment numbers originally was the reason she wanted the waiver, but again, she went and reconfigured it, so she's okay.
Okay, and we'll be looking at those numbers to add the additional teacher at the K level or whatever level we need to, as usual.
That's correct.
Okay, I have okay, thank you.
So I would like to withdraw. Yes. I would like to request that we withdraw the motion.
Okay, and then we'll move on to the next school, and
Southport.
That would be Southport.
Pleasant Prairie?
Southport.
No, I'm sorry.
Is that the last one?
No.
Right.
We have Warder and Whittier and Wilson.
Can I get a motion and a second for Southport, please?
I'll make a motion to approve the waiver for Southport.
All right, we have a motion and a second, and we are open for discussion, and I see Terry is joining us.
Jackie.
GM. Okay.
My sister's name is Terry.
Thank you. Well, I was close. I apologize for that. Welcome. Okay. We have Joanne up. Joanne?
You're actually, unless it's changed, staffed at 23-1, and you could have all straights without multi-age. And, of course, personalized learning can take place without that. So I'm wondering why we need to approve this. If your teachers work in families to meet the learning needs of children. Okay. Because there has been a lot of questions from parents from your building.
Okay. And I do think that a few of my staff members had emailed you all today. One of the things that our staff members had come together as a leadership team to decide how we wanted to do personalized learning. As we were going through the personalized learning journey last year, we found that working it in multi-age classrooms worked very well. The teachers were able to, through personalized learning, find out what kids' individual strengths were, what their how they read best, how they did math best. And so what the teachers were really excited about, and many parents too, was that they would be looping with their classrooms, with some of their students. So we have some of the one-two teachers from this past year will be, they'll be looping their last year's first graders into this year's second graders. So those second graders have the advantage of, not only does the teacher know their learning style, but they also know what's expected in the classroom. So now kids can, it becomes that rookies and veteran kind of situation where they know the classroom, what's expected, how the classroom procedures go. The teacher also has the advantage of, and I think that Dr. Hancock had forwarded you some data that we found on reading, where the teachers were able to get those gains early for multiple levels of growth for reading. So that we're really excited that we'll be able to carry that over into next year for those kids who loop with their teachers. We also have two teachers who looped from a from 1-2-3, from a 2-3 to a 3-4, and from a 1-2 into a 2-3. So those parents were very excited that they had the opportunity to experience that teacher for multiple years. In talking with Dr. Hancock over the weekend, we did create a plan that did have some, that had some options for parents. So if parents really didn't want to be a part of that multi-age environment, we created a few straight, we created a straight grade level classroom at every grade level, and I think two at grade five.
Okay, thank you. We have Kyle, and then you will be, Kyle will be followed by Tamara.
I simply ask my fellow board members to remember who we represent and remember that we're here for students, and that's all.
Thank you, Kyle. Tamara.
Thank you. Thank you. I just have one quick question. You mentioned that you parents were able to let you know if they didn't want their children in multi-age classes. Were those parents' wishes granted?
For the most part, yes. For this year, yes. For last year, we were entirely multi-age. No, okay, year. For this year, yes. Yes, that's not a problem at all.
Thank you.
And I have Joanne followed by Bob.
Have parents been given the opportunity, every single one, to opt in or opt out? Because you're saying they're given the opportunity, but some of them are saying, I didn't know I had the opportunity.
Right.
It hasn't been given to me yet.
No, and Mrs. Taube, it hasn't been, because this was a plan that we just put together over the weekend. So so what I've been doing is, as parents have been emailing, I've been saying, you know what, let's meet together, let's connect together, so that you know, so that we can get a good feel about, you know, where kids will be.
As far as knowing where kids will be, even if you have a fourth grade, a fifth grade, a third grade, teachers can know the same thing without multi-age if you use those techniques. You may not have the looping, but if teachers move up with their class, yes.
Right, but that also means that for those teachers that taught the 1-2 multi-age this year, that and they're looping their first grade students into the second grade, they will be working with the same curriculum from last year to this year to the next year. And so there's always that looping part where you're always going to have the veterans, you're always going to have the rookies. For those teachers that decided to loop, like Mrs. Polizzi, who went from a 1-2 to a 2-3, she'll be learning, she'll be coming up with a new, that was funny. she'll be spending time. Now she does. She's trained in personalized learning. So a lot of that will be personalized learning, but it's also adding in an additional curriculum for her, which she chose to do, and she really wanted to do.
She chose to do it, but yet as we look beyond reading and math or numeracy, we're having trouble meeting all of the science and social studies, I think so. And philosophically, I think we need to decide as a district where we're going to.
I do think that if you look at our WKCE results for fourth grade science and social studies, you'll be really pleased.
Okay, we have Bob followed by Mary.
I'm looking at, I'm getting a lot of letters from people, or emails, I'm sorry. I call them letters, but they're emails. So I could email someone back. I could email someone back that says, I want my child to be in a single class that they can get into it now, correct?
Correct.
Okay, so
I would hope that you would forward those to me so that I can, if it's somebody.
Actually, we would follow protocol and go through the superintendent's office.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just for clarification for Bob.
The superintendent gets all these emails, too.
Okay.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I don't.
Right.
Wait, point of order. He's got the floor.
Yeah, here's what I want to know. I see on this list here, which we know is not correct now, and so it's hard for me to make judgment calls when I see a list that's not correct, that you had all multi-age except for kindergarten last year.
Correct.
And so now you're telling me you're going to have multi-age and you're going to have single classes for single-age classes.
Correct.
Okay, and everybody will be able to get a choice. So everybody should be able to determine where their child's going to go.
Correct.
Okay, that's good for me. Thank you.
Okay, and then we have Mary.
I just wanted to say thank you for doing that. I know that you've been listening to problems that some people have with multi-age, and you've been willing to adjust and offer those opportunities because kids learn differently. We know that, and you know that. And some kids need the structure of a single age group, and you're providing that opportunity for those kids. And I thank you for going to the effort to redoing this to make sure that everybody's covered. So thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Tamara.
I thank you, too, for doing this. We did receive a lot of inquiries about this school. But I just have one question, though. What is the timeline for parents to have that opportunity? Because I just get concerned with school starting in, 2 weeks.
Right.
So when are parents going to be notified that this opportunity is available for them?
Right. Well, first I'll start with the parents who have emailed. And then our PTO president actually had put a letter out through our PTO listserv today talking about multi-age and things like that. And she did get a few folks back who were very much in favor of it and a few folks back who were not in favor of it. So first I would start with those folks who have emailed already and meet with them and try to kind of, try to kind of present to them, a little bit more and stuff and then offer them that opportunity. I think that we have to manage to kind of go through our PTO listserv, or we could always, if it's rolled over into Zangle, we could always do an all call where it would say, if you'd like to take a look, if you'd like to, reconsider this, we can connect.
So, no disrespect at all. So there really isn't a plan. There hasn't, except through PTO, there is no set plan to communicate to parents effectively about this opportunity.
No, because we just did this stuff over the weekend, and so we, I wanted to make sure that before we, rolled anything out, that, we would be, it would be approved.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I just have a couple of questions, Jackie. The number of teachers that will be doing the personalized learning, could you tell me, first of all, how many of your teachers were trained to do personalized learning? I know you were working with the CESA, and I'm really excited about that because I'm
Correct.
Hearing really positive things
yeah.
about that opportunity for personalized learning. But how many teachers actually were trained in that?
All of the teachers in our 1-2 family and all of the teachers in our 2-4 family went to summer training, even the new folks who came to us. So we were able to hire before that summer training. We have two folks in the 4-5 family who have experience with personalized learning. So we'll be working this year because personalized learning, a lot of it through CESA is a train the trainer model.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I like that too.
So we had actually, when we were doing the 1-2, we had informally expanded it to our kindergarten teachers and to our, to some of our older grade teachers.
Okay.
So, hopefully by the end of the year, we will have everybody
trained and on board.
Everyone will, everyone.
Excellent. Great.
We'll probably have that by mid-year because we have our professional development laid out, which I think Dr. Hancock had forwarded to you.
Okay.
And CISA 1 is very interested in us because they've authorized us to be a school to be visited to take a look at our personalized learning and the way that we implement it.
Okay.
So we've had two schools already that want to come and visit us.
Okay, great. And then with personalized learning, there is no requirement and that it has to be a multi-age classroom.
No, there's not a requirement, but this is how the teachers chose to
implement.
Got it.
Thank you very much. And I know there's a mix of both at your school, so I understand what you're trying to do.
Right.
I'm a little concerned with some of the looping and the grade, the span of the grade and things of that nature, because I don't know your staff, but I know that a teacher that's working with grade levels and all the different looping and everything, if they haven't had that experience, and I think that's a concern too. So
right.
I just wanted to share that with you.
One of the places that we did find difficulty last year when we were completely multi-age was the 2-3 combination, and this new plan eliminates that 2-3 combination. One of my teachers, Greg Jones, had come to me and he said, I really like the multi-age. If we have the opportunity, though, putting 2 and 3 together just seems to be really difficult. So in this new plan, it eliminates the 2-3.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that. We have a couple more questions, and then we need to move forward quickly. Board members, Kyle?
Just a real quick question through the chair to Dr. Hancock. When is the first day of school for students? September 3rd? Okay, and today is August 19th. That's all.
Okay, thank you, Kyle, and thank you for being brief. And Joanne, you are up for your second round.
In the communication we received this weekend, in addition to the teacher staff you have, you mentioned a need for educational assistant. And on what basis?
That was in reconfiguring the way that we'll be assembling the grades. It's now going to, we need to have a little bit more special ed coverage in the form of an ESP, because we'll have that special ed teacher going between two classrooms. So right now we have one ESP split between two special ed teachers, and so some students we do have some pretty profound disabilities within Southport, kids who need to have either a teacher or an ESP with them 100% of the time.
I am just wondering, did you have that need and just weren't able to fill it in the past?
Well, we actually had the two grade levels where we needed it together, but now we've separated those two grade levels.
Because I know you do have some kids with a lot of special needs.
Yeah.
But is the district able to provide that? Is that the first priority for the district? You're asking for that when I'm looking at with straight staffing.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
You are treated very well with staff.
Thank you, and I want to thank you for all the work that you're doing, and I understand it's a transition time, but we really do need to move forward. We have a motion and a second on the floor to approve the waiver for Southport Elementary. Roll call vote, please. Stacy?
Mrs. Taube?
No.
Mr. Flood?
School's about to begin. The communication plan's not there. No.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
No.
Mr. Bryan?
No.
Ms. Stevens?
No. Motion fails, and we'll have to see what you have and work through that. So we appreciate it. Thank you very much. All right, we have up next Whittier, followed by Wilson. And I see Jolene is coming up to join us. So do I have any lights for Whittier questions, please? Turn on your lights if you have. Oh, I need a motion. A motion and a second, please.
So moved.
Second? We have a motion and a second. Lights, Kyle?
Quick question for Dr. Hancock, and two, maybe it's Tarek, maybe it's Dr. Williams. But now, with the waivers we've approved so far, how much money, if no more waivers were approved, how much money would we still need to find in the budget right now? I don't have it all in front of us, but what have we reduced it to?
Just for a point of clarity, if the staff, if you did not approve the waivers, then we would have to go back into the budget and find money.
I believe, do you have a figure for us that, thank you, Sharonda.
Yeah, as Dr. Williams said, right now, if we,
it's on.
We, first of all, based on how many schools are left, but this is so we don't have to ask for additional monies. So, but with that being said, because I understand where you're going, yes, if we can get through the staffing piece, because we still have so many numbers fluctuating in different things like that, we really can't tell you. This is our best guess based on our projections. So it's why we ask for the contingency. So, and remember, the contingency is district-wide. So we still have not addressed any middle school or high school issues. So if we don't continue to approve the waivers, because as we put it, we would need any additional staffing based on the waivers. If you decide not to grant the waivers, then of course we would have to look at staffing there.
Okay. Right. Thank you for that clarification piece on that, Sharonda. And we do understand that we only have a certain amount set in our contingency. Right. So, board members, let's move on. We have Joan.
So, just one thing.
Do we miss
though,
okay.
So, just for example, you just stated no to Southport for a waiver. So that means now that they need an additional two teachers, which at a rate of $95,000 mean that that's roughly $200,000 that we have.
And we do understand what we did there. So okay, thank you. Okay. That is part of the contingency. I appreciate you bringing us up to speed on that. Thank you. Okay. So we have Jolene Schneider here from Whittier. And do we have any questions for Jolene about, did we get a second? I mean, a motion and a second on that? We did, didn't we?
We already did.
Thank you.
I motioned.
Okay, any questions? We have Joanne. Joanne?
Okay, what came out this weekend was two additional teachers for Southport. Is that what you're...
Joanne?
I am looking at how we're staffing, Bob, because I looked at this weekend was 23-1. We're looking at higher numbers here. And she
I think your point is at Southport. The clarification piece that she's looking at Southport is you're going from 23 size classrooms, and so that's going to be reconfigured. So when that data is available, what she's saying is you may not need as many teachers. So can we move forward from that point and get clarification around that? Because we really did make that decision. So let's move forward with Whittier and Wilson.
I think that I need clarification on what we've done, because I do not like to see a first, second split with 27 children.
At Whittier is what you're saying?
At Whittier. Okay. And that's what I'm seeing on this paper.
Let's talk about Whittier. That's right.
If you look at the numbers for Whittier today, my fourth and fifth grade changed. So we now have 3 5th grade and 3 4th grade. So the multi-age that I have right now is a K-1. My numbers for kindergarten right now are 28. Excuse me, I'm sorry. My numbers right now for kindergarten are 26, 27. My numbers for first grade are 26, 27. And my multi-age is 27. That's a K-1. Okay?
That's where your problem is.
All right.
Yes, it is.
Okay, I have no other multi-ages at this time.
Okay, so Kyle?
Yeah, I just want to clarify now, because I found the number I was looking for. So by not approving Southport, we need two additional teachers. That's about $200,000. If we do not, yes, I know. If we do not approve the next two, it's $400,000. That is not that hard to find in our budget. I have some ideas. I know Mr. Nuzzo has some ideas. That's not that hard to find in our budget. Again, I encourage the board to not approve any more waivers.
Okay, so any other questions for Ms. Snyder, Jolene Snyder at this point, Principal Snyder? Bob?
Yes, I'm concerned about that number in a multi-age classroom, kindergarten, first grade. I can't go there. So I think we just need to add another teacher there.
Okay, thank you. We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion based on that? Okay, then I'm going to call for a roll call vote on Whittier, please, Stacy.
Mrs. Taube?
To add a teacher, the waiver.
No, it's just for the waiver.
The waiver is yes or no.
I'll vote yes for the waiver.
Oh, one moment.
Just a minute. No, I'm voting against the waiver because I want...
I was going to correct you.
Okay. Roll call vote. Mrs. Taube said no.
I'm looking at one that I'm glad so...
So that was a no, Mrs. Taube, correct?
That's a no.
We want to shift teachers if we can. If we can. And typically we do. Like Rebecca said, you all, those of you that are seasoned educators know that. Though on those first 3 weeks, her numbers could look that way, and then we have teachers at another school where the numbers are down, and we have to move teachers. Teachers are used to that during the first 2 to 3 weeks. We will come back. I caution you about constantly adding at this point because you really need to look at that piece of it. Don't lose that piece. We put a contingency plan with money there to help us if the need be.
Okay.
I
understand.
Because we haven't done middle school, high school.
Okay. I understand, and I think I have one more question for Ms. Jolene Snyder, Principal Snyder, before I continue the roll call vote. I apologize, Stacy. I need to get this out, though. What are your numbers typically? Do you have a lot of flux at Whittier as far as ins and outs? And because some of our schools, we have a well-developed pattern, and you've been there... What, 2 or 3 years now, maybe?
I've been there 2 years. I do agree that we should wait for the third Friday count and then see the numbers.
As long as we're following board policy and we can bring that back around for you because there, yeah. I do agree with Mr. Nuzzo and with Joanne about Bob and Joanne that those are not acceptable. And I know we are addressing these
but
things.
But understand,
so, okay.
we've given her two teachers. When we tried, right, correct?
Yes, I received a teacher today, and I received another teacher
she's,
earlier.
She's been receiving teachers.
We continue to grow at Whittier.
Yeah,
and
they
so,
continue to
it.
Grow, though.
All right, that's good. I was rushing the
So they're on top of it, and they've been watching me and watching our numbers.
Okay, very good.
Taking care of
it. Absolutely.
Okay, so I appreciate that. I'm sorry, I'm trying to move this meeting along quickly. Just your numbers, we're like, we're very concerned. We want to make sure we support you and your staff. Okay, so we've got a roll call vote. Should we just start at the beginning?
Mrs. Taube?
No.
Mr. Flood?
No.
Mr. Nuzzo?
No.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
No.
Ms. Stevens?
Yes. Motion fails. Waiver is not granted, and we will move on then to Wilson.
Thank you very much.
Can I get a motion, please, for Wilson Elementary and the waiver? And a second, please?
Second.
Thank you. And we have principal from Wilson here. Yolanda is here to join us, so thank you for coming in. Do I see lights for questions? Any questions? Questions? Joanne?
We are looking at actual numbers that you have today, right? Because you have already started as an extended year school.
We have already started,
and you're a
yes.
small enough school that students do not come in neat packages with grades.
That
I do not
well.
Like the kindergarten first split. Had you planned that originally?
Yes, we did.
Uh, You have one that has 18, one that has 20, and one that has 22. So you're averaging 20.
Yes.
How is it working out?
Very well. We had multi-age classrooms last year, and teachers voted to continue with multi-age classrooms this year. I started out with two K-1 classrooms, and then we went to three.
You have larger, well, not really larger ones, at your upper grades. So this is basically a formality of what's happening.
All right, thank you. Kyle?
I mean, Wilson's already started, and this will, then we'll surprise you guys, but I mean, I will support this waiver. We can't, it would just be unfair. It would just be unfair to say, oh, you've already started, now change this. That's just unfair. So next year.
Do we need to know anything else before moving forward, Yolanda? I just want to tell you, when I visited your school last year, I was very impressed with the way that it was implemented in the EL program, and everything you're doing there just really seemed to click, and you're a small school. So you have your different challenges with a very transient populations at times. So thank you. I know that it's a challenge, but I really do think what I saw there was very well organized. And
thank you. We feel good about what we're doing.
Excellent. I love that reading piece with the Common Core built in and everything. That was so cool. So you need to go visit to see what EL is about. Am I correct, Dr. Sue? They need to go visit
4420 33rd Avenue.
Go visit. She'll give you the tour, and you'll understand how these Common Cores are built into that EL piece, and it's so exciting because the kids are writing, and they are writing at a level that I'm like, this is cool. So I'm done. I'll get off my soapbox. We have a motion and a second. May I get a roll call vote, please, Stacy?
Mrs. Taube?
Yes.
Mr. Flood?
Regrettably, yes.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Ms. Stevens?
Yes. Thank you very much, and have a lovely rest of your evening as well. All right, moving right along. We have just finished, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe we got all the waivers covered. And we're all still here smiling.
Mrs. Stevens.
Uh-oh. She's calling me out. What's going on,
this
Joanne?
This is not one that had requested a waiver, but I am looking at the Edward Bain Dual Language Program. And I see the principal is here. I was wondering if she could step forward so I could ask Betsyda a question.
This is not...
Well, I think that we have to stick with the agenda, but I would like you to follow up with an email on any of your concerns. No, thank you. Yeah.
And well, I'll just state what my concern is and not ask her. She probably is dealing with the enrollment that she had from last year, but I'm looking at some very large class sizes. And is there any way, if classes are over, that we cannot make it so other children are not enrolled in them?
I think that we should separate that issue, and we'll talk about that later. Thank you. We need to move forward with the agenda at hand. But it's an excellent question, Joanne. Okay, so at this point, then we have an agenda item, discussion action for the preliminary budget for the school year 2013-14. And again, I want to stress we need to move forward on this budget. And what? Am I missing something?
Is there any action needed on the policy? I'm just curious. I didn't know.
I think we're good.
Okay, I'm just curious.
Because we went through the waivers, the policy stands as presented, and that has the waiver built in, so principals can come forward, and the 20 and every reasonable effort made. So,
okay, I just want to clarify. Thank you.
I appreciate you bringing that up. Thank you. Okay. We do. Okay, so let's go with I need a motion to approve the preliminary budget for the 2013-14 school year. Can I get a motion, please?
I'll make a motion to approve the budget as submitted by administration.
And can I get a second, please? Can you please turn on your microphone and say that into the mic, Joanne?
I second it, but I will have a couple of
right.
questions,
discussion.
If I can limit it to that.
We're open for discussion, and it begins with Joanne, and then you will be followed by Kyle. Oh, you made the motion. I'm sorry, Bob. You're first. You didn't turn your light on, though.
No, I didn't. I think the, you know, we made some decision that's going to cause some staffing changes. I don't think they are of any order of magnitude that we have to do anything with this budget. And I think we've been through this quite a bit. I think I understand most of it. I want to congratulate administration because we kind of went through this very difficult, with a fine-tooth comb, and we haven't made a lot of changes to what administration did here, so I was pleased that with that. I think we've got this budget as fine-tuned as we can do, and I support it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bob. And now we have Joanne, followed by Kyle, followed by Carl.
I'm looking at items 66 and 67. I know we took out the money in 66 for an adoption until after it's been piloted, and I would just like to know how you came up with the figure of 200,000. Yes, 200,000. Is that just so you would have enough?
Is your mic on?
That's a complete estimate.
I know it says estimate, but estimates sometimes are based on something.
There is no real rationale behind the $200,000 number at this
moment. It's just so we'll have some money if we need it.
Yep.
Okay.
Because it's four pilot programs, so.
Hopefully the companies will also bring in some resources for us, too.
We actually had it. We were originally going to keep the same dollar amount that was requested for the original assumption. Just for clarity, but you know, balancing it out, we brought it down to two.
I'm just hoping that the companies want our business and will help provide some of those materials for us to use.
And I think we should have Joanne talk to them.
Well, I just know how eager. I just know how eager in the past they've been to have Kenosha Unified's business.
So. Sorry, I'll get back to business now.
Okay, now 67. What was moved from Fund 80 to amount to $690,000.
Okay, I can give you an overview of what that number included. It included several staffing positions.
Which ones?
I can read them off for you. The web specialist position, the executive director of community partnerships and media relations position, interactive communication specialist positions, an instructional technician, two part-time secretarial positions. That was the staffing components. And then there's actually a net effect in there where there is some money that can be put into Fund 80 for a part of our athletics director and recreation department salary. So there'll be a little bit of an offset for that, which is something that has been planned for in the past. It just hasn't really been executed, because you have to define how much time of that person is really being spent overseeing, for instance, the rec department. Once we can get a finite, some kind of rationale to how much we can charge to the community service fund, we can do that now. And then the other part of that is the operating budget for the whole communications department, which is in the $80,000 range, and then a $200,000 contract with Kenosha County for community outreach program. But now that one is kind of in the air now. We're waiting to see some more clarification from DPI whether or not the justification can be there to remain in Fund 80. At the moment, it looks like it's strictly servicing our Kenosha Unified students, but if we can change the program to expand beyond that and be more open towards community, we may be able to justify it within the Fund 80 program, so that could come back.
We also receive some grants that are administered or funded through the county, don't we? You're not talking about those.
Sure we do, but that's nothing.
That's not here. That's someplace else. They work with our students who have special needs.
That's correct.
Not special ed necessarily, but special needs.
That is not what this is. This contract was formerly funded under the Bridges program, which was a district cost.
This is a lot to add to our budget. It's not that, it's just the funding source. We've been doing these things. There are no new positions, are there?
No. This is part of a correction. Some of this stuff was placed into Fund 80 during the budget cut era, and now it needs to come back, because now with Act 20, Fund 80 community service funds are being scrutinized. There's an extra lens of scrutiny on them, and we really need to clean it up.
So this comes under our revenue cap?
It will once it comes down to Fund 80 or Fund 10. When it comes back to Fund 10, it is subject to the revenue limit.
And so we're looking at, and I'm in no way saying do away with the communications, but that equals at least 7 teachers. Right?
Sure. That math is correct.
And I'm thinking ahead if we have tighter times in preparing for next year's budget.
You also have, just for a point of clarification there, you have staff members that are currently working and have signed contracts or whatever HR documents may be. You know, they're in place working at the moment.
I realize
so this
that.
Is just, this is a cleanup, more of a cleanup issue.
Right. Okay. Thank you. Kyle, followed by Carl.
Just real quick, I'm supporting this motion because it is a preliminary budget, but I want to clarify something on public record. That line item 24, the new HR position, is that hiring being held up for until a certain time? Could I just hear how long that's being held up for on public record, please?
Sharonda.
We most certainly want to take care of the classrooms first. So we will wait until Third Friday to make sure that we have enough budget dollars to make sure that we take care of all of our hotspots in the classroom. And then we will come back and ask for approval of that. And this is a preliminary budget, so we can move forward, but we most certainly recognize where our priorities are, and most certainly we'll come back and ask once we finalize that.
Thank you.
All right. We'll move to Carl, followed by Bob.
I just wanted to briefly interject with having been the person that originally made the 25-1 motion. I appreciate the work that you guys did to make the adjustment. I know not everyone believed in me, Bob. I remember he voted against it at the Finance Committee level, but we made it work, and I just wanted to thank you for the amount of work that you did. Just to briefly also repeat what was discussed at the Finance Committee, that, you know, as this, because this is a fluid document, that as this continues to evolve before final adoption, that, you know, those adjustments, whatever the adjustments they may be, that, you know, they continue to be presented before the committee and or the board, depending on, you know, your discretion, that, you know, for public consumption, that's what we're doing. Okay, thank you.
Very good. Bob?
I pushed it by mistake. You can't unpush it. You
accidentally
push
it. Okay. So seeing no other lights, we have a motion and a second, and let's do a roll call vote on this one as well. Stacy, thank you.
Mrs. Taube?
Yes.
Mr. Flood?
Yes.
Mr. Nuzzo?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Yes.
Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Ms. Stevens?
Yes, we passed the budget, preliminary budget.
Thank you.
Unified, all 7 votes. So thank you for all your hard work.
Money.
We're going to be come back asking for more. Can I get a motion to adjourn please, in a second? All right, all in favor of adjourning, say aye. We are adjourned. Thank you very much.